Hello and welcome back. Today we're going to continue the metabolism inside the mitochondrion and we're going to focus on the Krebs cycle. Let's begin. So we were left off with the acetyl-CoA, two molecules of acetyl-CoA from one glucose. And acetyl-CoA is going to bind with oxaloacetate. We already viewed this guy in the gluconeogenesis. He's involved in the conversion of pyruvate into phosphoenolpyruvate. So, acetyl-CoA with oxaloacetate via the citrate synthase. This is an enzyme that is inhibited by ATP, NADH, citrate, and succinyl-CoA. We will see what succinyl-CoA is in a few moments. But ADP in this case is stimulating this enzyme to create citrate. Citrate is a 6-carbon molecule. As you can see, we get 2 from the acetyl-CoA and 4 from the oxaloacetate. Citrate is then converted into isocitrate by the use of an aconitase. Isocitrate is then converted into alpha-ketoglutarate. We use an isocitrate dehydrogenase. And remember, every time you hear dehydrogenase means NAD positive to NADH. In this process we lose a carbon in form of CO2. This carbon actually goes outside the mitochondrion. The isocitrate dehydrogenase is inhibited by high quantities of ATP, because indeed this process is going to create more ATP at the end. And it's stimulated by ADP and calcium. Okay, ADP, yes, of course, but why calcium? Well, if you think, calcium has a big role on contracting muscles. You need calcium to create contraction, and for contracting you need ATP. If you're contracting your muscles, you want energy. So that's why calcium is stimulating this process to occur. Once we have alpha-ketoglutarate, which is a 5-carbon molecule, we're going to convert it into succinyl-CoA, the guy we saw previously. In the process, we're going to use the alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase and once again, NAD positive to NADH. We're going to lose another carbon in form of CO2 that will go outside the mitochondrion. And this enzyme is regulated by NADH. If there is too much NADH, this enzyme is inhibited, as well as if there is too much succinyl-CoA. But is stimulated once again by calcium. In this process, also CoA is playing because we have to put a CoA into this molecule. So this is a 4-carbon molecule with a CoA. Then succinyl-CoA is converted into succinate. We don't lose carbons here. We use the succinyl-CoA synthetase. And we lose the CoA. In the process, GDP is going to get converted into GDP, which is energy. But this phosphate group is stolen pretty easily by the ADP to create ATP. So in this process, we create ATP directly. Succinate is then converted into fumarate. Via the succinate dehydrogenase, we get FAD to FADH2. Okay, so that's a dehydrogenase, but it's not NAD positive to NADH. This one is the exception. It's pretty common to know this one, because succinate dehydrogenase is the complex number 2 of the electron transport chain. which we are going to see in the next videos. Fumarate is then converted into malate via a fumarase enzyme, which is going to add water to it. And then malate is going to create oxaloacetate again. And what enzyme? Malate dehydrogenase. Ding ding ding, dehydrogenase, NAD positive to NADH. And that's it, that's the Krebs cycle. Okay, so there are a lot of names here, enzymes. You have to know that there is a little mnemonic to remember all of this pretty easily. So you start with citrate. Citrate is Krebs with the K. Krebs starting substrate for making oxaloacetate. So citrate is Krebs starting substrate for making oxaloacetate. And then the enzymes you are going to need the most are the citrate synthase, which is not reversible, as you can see here, is a bigger arrow. Isocitrate dehydrogenase, I mean the name of the previous molecule with DH, dehydrogenase. Alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase, and you have to remember that isocitrate dehydrogenase is going to get rid of carbon in form of CO2, alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase as well, and that the succinyl-CoA synthase is going to create ATP in the end. And of course, the succinate dehydrogenase is creating FADH2, not NADH. So, to recap, one Krebs cycle creates three NADHs, one FADH2, and one GTP that is converted into ATP. But one glucose molecule creates two pyruvates that create two acetyl-CoA. So we have to go for two cycles, and in the end we get six NADH, two FADH2, and two ATP from the Krebs cycle. Then the NADH and the FADH2, those are going to get into the electron transport chain. Okay, so now we're going to view how the NADHs from the glycolysis can get inside of the mitochondrion, because normally they cannot get inside as they are. They have to go through some processes so they can enter the mitochondrion properly. So here we have two ways, two shuttles. This is the first one, which is the malate aspartate shuttle. It begins with oxaloacetate, our friend, that gets converted into malate. And as you can see here, the NADH gets converted into NAD positive. So we are basically transferring those electrons to the malate. Then malate can enter the mitochondrion. Malate inside the mitochondrion is converted back into oxaloacetate. And here we can go from NAD positive to NADH. And that's a form for transferring NADH inside the cell. But oxaloacetate has to leave the cell. So it gets bind to glutamate or aspartic acid to create aspartate and alpha-ketoglutarate. This is a metabolite of the Krebs cycle, and aspartate leaves the mitochondrion via the same channel and then is converted back into oxaloacetate via the same reaction, which is reversible, gets together with alpha-ketoglutarate and creates oxaloacetate and glutamate. This is the malate aspartate shuttle. Then we have the glycerol free phosphate shuttle. If you remember from the glycolysis, we have the dehydroxyacetone phosphate, which comes from the split of fructose 1,6 bisphosphate. Again, this can be converted into glycerol free phosphate, and NADH is converted to NAD positive. So glycerol free phosphate is going to store those electrons inside of him. Then glycerol free phosphate enters the mitochondrion and gets converted back to dehydroxyacetone phosphate via the glycerol free phosphate dehydrogenase. As being a dehydrogenase, it has to do something with hydrogen and electrons. So it gets FAD and creates FADH2. FADH2 then can enter the electron transport chain as well as NADH. And those are the mechanisms of getting the NADH from glycolysis inside the mitochondrion. I will leave everything in the description below so you can check this beautiful picture every time you want and study it very well. Okay, so that's it for this video. I hope you liked it, and leave me a comment down below if you have any question or suggestion. I will enjoy your feedback. Thank you for watching.